what I will speak about today is loosely intertwined with the Hadamard lectures I'm currently giving here. So I want to talk about the geometric Satake equivalence. In a certain setting. I don't want to claim that I can prove everything, but I want to say how one can get the handle on some key geometric step in the proof. OK, but let me first of all recall the classical setup. And so let's say a little k is an algebraically closed field for simplicity. And G over K, some reductive group. So then you have several different functors. You have the loop group of G. This is this functor which takes any k algebras to all two groups, mapping R to G of the wrong series over R. And in there, you have the positive loop group L plus G. Also a functor to groups. It takes a power series valued points. So these are both, say, FPQC sheaves. And the L plus G is actually in. No, we lost everybody.
No,
okay. Not so much has happened. So I want to talk about geometric Satake, and I started by recalling the classical setup, where I work, say, over an algebraically closed field and have my reductive group G. And then I have the loop group of G, which takes any k-algebra R to the group, which is the wrong series valued points of G. And inside there, you have the positive loop group, which takes us to the power series valued points of the field. And then L plus G is actually an affine scheme, but of infinite type. So it's the inverse limit of the R adjoint T mod T to the n valued points, which are some restriction of scalars along this. And L plus LG was in some kind of in scheme. You could write it as an increasing union where you bound the poles of this Laurent series. And then the affine Grassmannian is the, let's say it's the FPQC sheafification. It's not really necessary to do FPQC. You could just do it all. of the loop group as a positive loop group. And actually, there's a direct way to say what this is as a functor. It's just classifying the following data. It classifies G torsors. What was my name for the G torsor? I didn't give it a name. Let's call it E. Over the spectrum of the Laurent series, over the power series field, plus a trivialization. Of E restricted to the punctured thing. OK. Okay, so if you trivialize the torsor, then giving such a thing is just giving the trivialization over the Laurent series field, which is an element of the loop group. And then you model out by the ambiguity of taking a trivialization over R power series T. And so, maybe also if G is GLN, this is something pretty explicit. It's just a set lambda, or lambda, which are some fine projective R power series T lattices.
And contain lattices, okay.
Okay, and so the basic theorem about the geometry of these guys is that it's what's called a strict int projective scheme. So strict refers to the fact that the transition maps are closed immersions. And maybe I should have said that you also have an action of the positive, well, actually of the whole loop group, but in particular of the positive loop group on the Grassmannian, which is clear from this description of the quotient there. And the L plus G orbits are in bijection with core characters of a maximal torus, and then you take dominant guys. So say you fix the maximal torus in the Borel in G. Via mu maps to mu of t. So mu of t is then an element in the loop group of G. And in particular, reduces to a point in the affine Grassmannian. And for, so you have these open Schubert cells, little g mu, which are this L plus g times this point mu t. And there, and usually one takes the reduced closures of these guys to call them 3G mu bar. Well, actually, no. Let me note the open Schubert cells by a knot and then the non-open guys just this way. So there are some projective varieties, usually singular. Varieties. And okay, and so this whole thing is the union of these guys along closed immersions. And then there is a geometric Satake equivalence. So was over the complex numbers done by Mirkovich and Vilonen. And then there are some other papers, maybe by Timo Richards and Xinwen Zhu, which discuss the case of other fields. So, oops, maybe I'll use the next board to say this. So you can look at the category of perverse sheaves on this affine Grassmannian, and you look at the L plus G equivariant guys, actually. Well, I should have switched those words, perverse L plus G equivariant sheaves. It's better if you could exchange those words. on the affine Grassmannian. And actually, what Merkovich and Vilonen say, but which hasn't been taken up by Richards and Zhu so far, I believe, is that if you do this actually with ZL coefficients, so integrally. So Richards and Zhu, they work in with the QL coefficients here. But it should also be true with ZL coefficients. And this is equivalent to the category of representations of the dual group. Representations on finitely generated ZL modules.
So in particular, it's true with FL coefficients?
It's also true with FL coefficients, yeah. Where G dual is a Langen's dual group. How does this work? So this works in such a way that if you take a highest weight representation V mu here, which does make sense integrally, then this corresponds to an intersection complex mu here, where, well, mu is a dominant co-character for T, but that's the same thing as a co-character of the dual torus, which is again positive. And so such co-characters, they parameterize these, well, what characteristic zero would be the reducible representations of highest weight mu. And you have this relation. L is not equal to the characteristic of K.
So the G dual is split necessarily.
I mean, I'm working on an algebraically closed field, so anyway, yeah.
So the topology of this, when you walk over C, and you change, so if you somehow the topology relative to constructive like Z, this shouldn't change when you pass to characteristic P different from L. Is this the
So you wonder why the statement is independent of the choice of the field K? Is that the question?
So is it easy to see that?
No, it's not. I don't think it's a tautology that if you vary the characteristics, so if you put a family of affine Grassmannians over spec Z or something like this, that you get the same category in all characteristics, I don't think is a priori clear. I think it's not clear that you get the same answer. There are cell decompositions and the resolutions, but I mean, there is some finer structure like these. Okay, I mean, this is not just an equivalence of categories. There's some extra structure. There's symmetric monoidal structure. And getting all of this equivalently, I mean, there's some work to do. I mean.
But what lattice is it in this highest weight representation?
Well, I think there's a unique one which has the highest weight integrally, where this highest weight generates the whole representation. If someone takes the highest weight, I mean, there's up to scaling a unique one, just the scaling doesn't matter, so you pick one, and then you take this lattice generated by this highest weight. I mean, also, if I work integrally, I have to be careful what I mean by perverse, because there are two dual perversities, and I would need to specify which one I take. And yeah. Well, you can look it up and work which one alone. I might get it wrong if I try to say it. right. I think that's what I wanted to say. Ah, yeah, right. So this is an equivalence of symmetric monoidal categories. And so it's clear what the symmetric monoidal structure is on representations of the dual group. It's not as clear what you do here. So here's just tensor product. So what you have to do here, you have to there's a convolution product. So if you do want the monoidal structure, you can define this as a convolution product. So essentially, this uses that if you take this LG mod L plus G, well, if you take some kind of L plus G equivariant thing, then this has a natural map to LG mod L plus G. And so if you have two such perverse sheaves, which are also L plus G equivariant, you can make one on this big guy. Because locally, this is more like a product of two copies of this. And then you push it forward under this map. But this is not clear that this is symmetric. It's not clear that it's commutative. And so to get a symmetric monoidal structure, the usual argument actually proceeds by giving a different construction of this convolution product. Namely, it uses the so-called fusion product. And I want to talk about this later in the setting I'm in. But let me only note for now that this, for this you have to work over several copies of the base curve. The base curve in this case is something like k power series t. So in this case, you have to work over power series ring in two variables and then specialize to the diagonal. So I have to stick to the middle. OK, great.
So for ZL, I think the tensor product has also tau 1. So you expect to have
Right. I mean, so you have to be a bit careful. So if you restrict to some kind of free guys, torsion free guys on both sides, then this works nicely. If you don't, then of course, on the category of representations, there are tau 1 terms. And so you wouldn't expect that the convolution of two perverse things is again perverse, but there might be some extra kind of tau 1 term appearing, which you would have to neglect again. OK, so I want to talk about a version in p-adic geometry. So which entails something like replacing k power series t by maybe the Witt vectors of k. And so this can be done. And that's the theorem of Xin Wen Zhu. So let's say G is over the Witt vectors of K, where K, let's say again, is an algebraically closed field of characteristic P. Reductive group. And then you consider the following variant of the affine Grassmannian. Which you only define on perfect K-algebras. Sets which takes R to the set of all G-torsors over the spectrum of the Witt vectors of R. Which are now, in the case of a perfect algebra, some nice ring, E plus the trivialization of E restricted to the punctured guy, which now means takes the Witt vectors and invert P. And again, you have an action of the loop group, in particular of the positive loop group, which is a thing which takes R to G of the Witt vectors of R. And let me just abbreviate his theorem by saying that the similar results hold true. Where the small part of this is actually a theorem of Bhargav Bhatt and myself, namely that these guys are, that these closed Schubert cells are perfections of projective varieties. So Zhu only proved that they are algebraic spaces, which was enough for him to go on. And so the much more difficult part of the theorem is the geometric Satake equivalence. And okay. So Zhu actually had to use a trick. For the geometric Satake equivalence. Because he didn't have an analog. So to get the symmetric symmetric model structure, we have no analog. Of such a two-variable algebra. So instead, he used this, I think due to Gelfand. So the Gelfand had this trick of proving commutativity of these spherical Hecker algebras by using some involution of the group, some anti-involution, which gave you an anti-self isomorphism of the Hecker algebra, which then showed it must be commutative. And there was a way to do this geometrically. and that's how Zhu could pull this off. So. I think it's Gelfand, right? This doesn't. Right.
So if you have an automorphism of G, right. It clearly acts on this, on all the categories.
Right.
Okay. And so is there usually the action, let us say, for inner automorphism, the action is trivial or canonically trivial? Or?
Yeah, I mean, there was some subtlety in getting this to work because he had to check some coherences between the monoidal convolution structure and the symmetry isomorphism. And checking those actually came down to some combinatorial identities, which he could only prove because they were the same as an equal characteristic. And the equal characteristics, they follow from geometric Satake. So it's actually this kind of convoluted argument.
The group is not constant. It's in the
general. Well, I mean, in this case, it's somehow a constant. I mean, this is a split group in this case, right? So.
Not automatically, but maybe we assume that.
Why?
It could be ramified.
No, it's a reductive group integrally, so it's like unramified. It's unramified, and I work over an algebraically closed field, so it's actually a split group. So I don't have any issues here. OK. So, right? But actually, that's not the theorem I need in the context of these lectures I'm currently giving. So for Fox conjecture, we need actually a version for some Biederman plus Grassmannian. So Biederman plus is a ring defined by Fontaine and p-adic theory. It's again a complete discrete valuation ring, as k power series t, or the Witt vectors of k. But now the residue field is CP. And so, of course, it's abstractly isomorphic to CP power series t, but not canonically so. And once I make some functor on some test category, it actually is genuinely different from a power series ring. And so, say if G over Biederman plus is again a reductive group, which again must be split automatically. you can do the similar thing. So again, you have a affine Grassmannian for G. Where now the test category is kind of similar as in Ju's setup. We have to restrict to some perfect algebras to get a well-defined analog of the Witt vectors. So you have to now perfectoid CP algebras, which, by the way, I will maybe in a moment conflate with algebras over the tilt by the tilting equivalence. Two sets. Which, well, does a similar thing. So it takes it to the set of G torsors over. And now there's a construction which takes any such perfectoid CP algebra and produces an analog of this ring Biederman plus, but somehow now for this family R. So there's a Biederman plus algebra, which if I tensor to the residue field CP, I get back the algebra R. So it's a flat deformation to Biederman plus, plus a trivialization over what's called the fraction. What's an around the fraction field of this DBR. And this is Biederman plus. Okay, so you can consider this similar object. And again, you have an action of an L plus G on it. And now in, so maybe actually make a remark. How is this related to the previous guy? There is a relation between these two. If G is defined over matrix of K already, which it implicitly always is because it's always split, and then you can take a split form over the Witt vectors. Then we can define a family of affine Grassmannians. Which is some kind of Beilinson-Drinfeld type family. Which lives over something I would call the diamond associated with the vectors of K. So these are, technically, these are all functors on perfectoid spaces and characteristic P, where the fiber, the special fiber, is a Witt vector affine Grassmannian.
So the WK is not
it's not analytic, but you can still define this as a V sheaf in the context of my course. So the special fiber is this thing that was defined by Xin Wenju and is essentially a scheme. And the generic fiber, meaning over CP, is the speedrun plus Grassmannian. And it's, there's a more classical situation if you have a smooth projective curve, say, and it need not be projective, just some smooth curve, and you have a reductive group over it. Then you can also build a family of affine Grassmannians over the curve, whose fibers at each point are some affine Grassmannian corresponding to the complete local ring at this point. Oops, now I need to sneak behind here. So as usual, you have, one can describe the L plus G orbits. And define Schubert varieties. Oh, well, let me put varieties in quotes because they are now quite far from actual varieties. And a theorem that was the main theorem of my Berkeley course was that these Grigi mu's, let me put the speed around plus here to make clear what I'm talking about. This Grigi mu belongs to this world of diamonds that I'm considering. So technically, it's a proper and spatial diamond, proper separated. Spatial diamond over the diamond for CP. And so the course so far implies that you can do a tall cohomology. We have a six functor formalism of a tall cohomology in the setup. Cohomology for these objects. And so in particular, using some abstract results of Ofer-Gerber, one can make sense of perverse sheaves on these guys. And also L plus G covariant perverse sheaves. On the speed round plus plus one. And all right, I should get somewhere soon. We can also define a convolution product. And for this, you have to check by hand that the convolution morphism is semi-small, which you can do. So can also define. Convolution product. But to get the symmetric structure, well, you could cheat again and use trick, which probably works. But actually, it's even necessary to have this picture with these higher dimensional bases for Fock's conjecture. So I really want a fusion product. Yeah?
do you want some constructibility notion here to define?
I mean, if the L plus G equivalence, it must automatically be constant on all the open Schubert cells, which gives you some constructibility with respect to that. And then, of course, you want that on each stratum there are local systems, I mean, of finite rank, which actually must be automatically constant by L plus G equivalence again.
And of course, you have to check the operations preserve this constructibility.
You have to check the operations preserve this constructibility. I mean, the somebody's gone. It's okay. I mean, the way to check this is that you can define some kind of Demersy resolutions of all these guys here, which are an isomorphism over the open L plus G orbit. And then you first check that everything behaves nicely on this resolution, where everything has somehow smooth locally the same thing as some standard guys you know from algebraic. Well, which are analytifications of algebraic objects. So you can control it there, and then you, well, you just push forwards on the proper maps and so on. You can control those things. Let me try to do it this way. Okay, so for the fusion product, let me actually assume that G is defined over, let me fix a model over the Witt vectors in word P to start with, and let me denote this guy here actually by L. Then in the world of diamonds, the issue with having this two-variable family actually go away. So we have can take the p-adic spectrum of L, pass to the diamond, and then you have such a two-variable guy. Let's call it two for two copies. And you can also define some Beilinson-Drinfeld Grassmannian over it. Which now, in the case of two copies of the curve, looks slightly different. It's not at each fiber an affine Grassmannian instead. So what does it parameterize? It parameterizes G torsors, over so the R-valued points. Well, actually, to be very precise, the R plus valued points parameterize G torsors over a space I denote by this bar of RR plus, and then it, in some sense, takes a fiber product over spar K with the p-adic spectrum of L. This can be defined in terms of the Witt vectors. So it's an open subspace. of the thing you get from the Witt vectors. E over this guy.
In the classical picture of the Witt vectors you described in the beginning, what would be this, the analogue of this?
For the Witt vectors, it doesn't. Well, you.
The two variable thing of just the Witt vectors.
No, already. There is no such thing for just the Witt vectors. So if you want to have these two variable guys, you implicitly already for one variable would have to do this Beilinson-Drinfeld Grassmannian, which lives over a small part of your curve. So implicitly, already for one variable, you would need the degeneration from this Witt vector affine Grassmannian to the Biederman plus Grassmannian. you don't really see this over a curve because there you could just, it's basically constant x. Well, not quite.
What did you say? No, I didn't get.
So you.
Is another approach instead of the. You say that you can define.
I want a fusion product, and so for this I need. So yes, I don't want to use Ju's trick, the Gelfand trick. And instead, I want to mimic more closely what's done classically with a fusion product. And for this, I need families of these Beilinson-Drinfeld Grassmannians over two copies of your curve. And my small punctured, this is like a little punctured disk, and I take two copies of it, which is now some.
So what you order with SPA, WR plus, WR plus, that's on the right hand corner. So what is WR plus is Witt vector over R plus, so it is an adic ring.
Right, with a p comma pi adic topology where pi is a uniform.
Okay, so it is still not an analytic?
It's not analytic, but the open subspace will be analytic. Okay, so essentially I look at the open subspace where p is not zero, and the Teichmüller of pi is not zero. Okay, so I look at these guys, but with a trivialization again. Graph of x1 at the graph of x2, which I maps from. Into here, where x1 and x2 are the maps from spar plus to spar L diamond, which give you the map here. And it turns out that giving such a map to spar L diamond is the same thing as giving an embedding of this adic spectrum into here with some properties, which is in some sense a graph of this map here. So away from the diagonal, goes the other way.
I don't understand. If you have a graph of something, then it is isomorphic to the source. And you are writing.
Sorry, yes, and that's what I mean. Sorry. And that doesn't make sense, so sorry. Sorry. Thank you. Actually, giving such a map is equivalent to giving an untilt, which I could call Ri sharp. So this corresponds to untilt R sharp, Ri's 1 and 2. And this untilt automatically embeds into here. Thank you. Sorry. Away from the diagonal, the fibers are isomorphic to two copies of the speedrun plus Grassmannian. So that's because giving a like if it's already trivialized away from these two points, then to understand the extension to a G torsor over everything, you just have to understand what happens infinitesimally near those two points. And that's given by the usual Bovey-Lussell lemma, which has an analog here, by this B-round plus Grassmannian. But over the diagonal itself, the fibers are just one copy. Because if you're over the diagonal, well then, giving isomorphism away from these two guys is just the same as away from one guy, and then you just get one copy. So this picture is actually really close to the usual picture for a curve. And so what you want to do is that if f and g are L plus g equivariant, which maybe for the moment is not critical, perverse sheaves, on the speedrun plus Grassmannian, then their exterior tensor product, the box product, defines the sheaf on this Beilinson-Drinfeld guy away from the diagonal. Because away from the diagonals is isomorphic to two copies. And so let's denote this open inclusion J into the whole guy. And what you want to do is you want to canonically extend this perverse sheaf here to a perverse sheaf on the whole guy. And it turns out that there is such a canonical extension. And for this, let's me assume that f and g are flat over ZL. If I look at the box product, this has a unique extension to what's called a universally locally acyclic ULA. And this is a notion I want to discuss in the 5 minutes or so that remain. ULA sheaf on this whole Beilinson-Drinfeld Grassmannian. And this extension is perverse. It's actually equal to the intermediate extension to this what's called J exclamation mark star. And the restriction to the diagonal is equal to the convolution product. Where the convolution product a priori depends on the choice of ordering. But this picture is obviously invariant under flipping the two factors, which gives you the symmetry. OK. And so so this follows the usual arguments. So this is how one proceeds classically. But one needs a good analog. So once one has a good definition, the right definition, of ULA, so let me, you can say this, universally locally acyclic.
So in the monoidal structure, one is also to verify an hexagonal and pentagonal.
Right, so there are these higher axioms, these higher compatibilities. These you check by passing to three copies of this picture and so on.
OK, so you need analogs with, OK.
Hmm?
High-category commutativity.
Well, I mean, there's this thing that if you try to do the thing for the whole derived category, there's actually not any infinity monoidal structure on this. It's only E2 or E3 or something like this. So actually. So this nice symmetric structure is actually really restricted to the perverse sheaves. Okay. So let me recall briefly the usual definition. ULA sheaves. So let's say F from Y to X is a map of schemes. Let's say finite type separated map of schemes. And F over Y is some sheaf. Well, it's actually, be more precise, it's some P plus constructible sheaf on Y with some yield coefficients. L is invertible on X as usual. Is F universally locally acyclic? If and so universally refers to the fact that this should be true after any base change. The following holds true that for all geometric points y bar of y, so this maps to x, this maps to some geometric point x bar of x. And I have another geometric point, eta bar, which specializes to x bar. And so you want that if you look at the sections of this, that's a strict generalization. Of F, that this is some the same over x bar is over eta bar, meaning if I base change this guy over the strict generalization of x at this point to eta bar, this is unchanged.
So what's your definition of the derived category? Is it?
Well, let's assume that everything is a finite type over a field. So that there, I don't think then there is. Is there a subtlety then?
No, because it depends on if you use your definition, if one uses the proetal, okay, construction rate. So. Because you are working not with, usually it is the dark.
Okay, let's work with torsion coefficients so that this issue goes away. okay, so it says something that if you have a specialization, so essentially it says something like the consequence. Is the following. Say if F is proper, then actually the cohomology of the fiber Y over X bar of is the same. Well, then if I take RF lower star F, then this is actually a local system. It's locally constant. And how do you prove this? Because it's always constructible. It's enough to prove that it's under specializations it's unchanged. And this invariant under specializations is precisely what's encoded in this kind of condition. But it's somehow encoded locally, whereas this is somehow then the corresponding global statement. So it's a statement that somehow the cohomology of Y with coefficients in F is somehow invariant as you move on the base X, in a sense. Oops. I should do this. Okay. So in analytic geometry, let's say for adic spaces. So for analytic adic spaces. The analog does not work. The obvious analog does not work. The problem is that there are no interesting specializations sufficiently. Interesting specializations in adic spaces. So
you mean to make sure that this thing about proper morphisms?
To make sure that the thing about proper morphisms say is true. So you certainly want a notion which has this implication. So for example, you might have a situation that you have some ball here and the point inside. Which is somehow roughly the situation we're in here with this diagonal inside this two-variable guy. And then you have some y over here. And then you have the fiber y naught in here. And then the kind of situation we're in is that f over y is maybe locally constant on y minus y naught. And we want to characterize uniquely the extension to x to all of y. Then you would somehow want to look at specializations which specialize into this closed point, but from a point in B. But there are no specializations. From B minus a point to the point. So all the specializations, they somehow either happen in this closed stratum, which here is just a point anyway, or in this open stratum. But then you're only talking about what happens on the individual strata where you know things are well behaved anyway. And so you can't a priori say anything about the variation as you change the stratum for the kinds of strata we care about here. So I'm already over time, but I want to give the definition.
The usual definition of ULI, it's with upper strict tensor product, it makes sense.
With what?
The definition with the upper strict tensor product of ULI.
Okay, there's another definition of ULA in the literature, and I don't know. So let me give a definition which is which works anyway, which is closer to the classical one. So we ask the following. One is the same condition for the specializations. You still put it in. But it's will, in the cases of interest, be always satisfied anyway. So that's not the critical part. Same conditions for specializations. But then you put a second condition, which is the following, that for all constructible sheaves, G on on y, the shriek push forward of the tensor product is constructible. Right, what does this mean, constructible? Constructible means it's locally constant. After passage to a constructible locally closed stratification. But you have to be a little bit careful about making this precise, because the strata might not be adic spaces themselves, but only pseudo-adic spaces. But there is a way to make sense of this condition.
The point is, there are constructible set in the sense of spectral spaces, but
yeah, in the sense of spectral spaces. Huh? No. In the sense of spectral spaces. Right. So this actually, I'm sorry for going over time, but if I'm not going over time, this whole talk doesn't have any sense. So what does constructible mean? So again, in our example, that you have this open, this closed immersion of a point into a ball. The issue is that I lower star of z mod l to the nz, this is not constructible. That's because part of the definition of a constructible locally closed stratification is, for example, if you have an open stratum, then the open stratum needs to be quasi-compact. And the issue is that if you look at b minus a point, then this is not quasi-compact. And so if you turn things around, the consequence is the following. If you have G over the ball, some constructible sheaf, then there exists an open neighborhood, U of the point, such that G restricted to U is actually locally constant. That's because constructible subsets of these adic spaces are slightly funny. So I mean, any constructible subset of a, if it contains a classical point, it automatically contains a small open neighborhood of this classical point. And so this means that if you apply this conclusion here, that actually in the neighborhood of each classical point, there will be a small neighborhood such that the cohomology over this this one point is the same as in the whole neighborhood. And in this way, you actually get this kind of local constancy around this closed point. And so, right, so if you put this extra condition in, which is, for example, satisfied if F is a local system and F is smooth and has some other nice properties which resemble the known properties of ULA sheaves for schemes, then you can actually get the argument running. OK, let me stop here.
OK, so we'll take a few questions. So maybe we start by Tokyo. Happy that we did not lost in between. So a few questions from Tokyo, then Beijing.
Yeah, so are there any questions? So I suppose that you want to prove this Fargue's conjecture. So you, so is this construction, are you ready to do that?
Prove Fargue's conjecture, or what? I mean, so far I'm just trying to give a proper formulation of Fargue's conjecture. So I mean, implicit in Fargue's conjecture is that there is a geometric Satake equivalence, and then only then you can really make sense of, and that there is a nice theory of sheaves on Bungee and so on.
there is this factorization shift property, and you really need this fusion product to make sense.
Right, and you need to So, I mean, so you really need this fusion product to make sense of everything. On the other hand, once you have a proper formulation of Fox conjectures, and as I said in my first lecture here, you actually automatically get a construction of semi-simple L parameters for all irreducible smooth representations. And maybe in the case of GLN or so, there's also it might be possible, but anyway, to do something. Right, I mean, for the moment, it's just about getting a proper formulation of all the objects in Fox conjecture.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? Yeah, that's it from Tokyo. Thank you.
So, Eugene?
Questions?
In your remarks, is it possible to construct a nearby cycle factor to use the fusion product argument to construct a symmetric monoid structure on the converse shift, the Witt vector Grassmannian?
Okay, I didn't completely understand the question, but I think it was whether there is some good theory of Purbusch nearby cycles in this setup. And so that's actually a good question. So for usual nearby cycles for schemes, there is in particular the theorem that if you have a Purbusch sheaf on the generic fiber and you take nearby cycles, it's again Purbusch. And this fails. Let me give you an example. So this means that you have to actually be a little careful. So let's say you have the ball times the ball via projection to the first vector mapping to the ball. And then the fiber here is a ball via the inclusion to the second vector. And then I claim that I can find a Purbusch sheaf on here, whose nearby cycles are not Purbusch. And so, okay, let me try to draw a picture for this. So let's say this is the ball, which is a special fiber. And then I have the generic fiber here, the ball times the ball. And what might happen, and then you have somewhere a fixed point x in this ball, and it has a the preimage and the specialization is some subset here, some open subset. So let me talk about the open. If I take it in the adic world, it's closed, but then I can take remove one rank 2 point and it's open. And what I can do is I can put a sheaf which is concentrated on some small part here. Let me try to get this right. I mean, you can take J Lorentz shriek from a small ball inside. So this is a small ball, small quasi compact ball. Oh, small. It's quasi compact one direction. And if this inclusion take J Lorentz shriek of my coefficient ring. And then, of course, the nearby cycles, so this can be checked to be Purbusch, then the nearby cycles are zero everywhere except at x. But at x, you get the compactly supported cohomology of this open subset. So if I take the nearby cycles, then this is concentrated at x and given by the compactly supported cohomology of this u, which is lambda in degree minus 2. And that's too far off to be perverse. So a related phenomenon is that the Artin vanishing theorem fails for rigid spaces. Again, because the ball, if you just take a closed ball, it's some affinoid space. And so you would expect that the cohomology of all constructible sheaves vanishes above degree 1. But then this J lower shriek of lambda for a smaller open ball inside gives you a sheaf where the cohomology is a compact support cohomology of this U. But this goes up until degree 2. And so this Artin vanishing fails.
So here you are considering B cross B. No, I don't understand what situation you are considering. You're considering the formal model of a ball over spec of the evaluation ring, or you consider ball cross a ball?
Well, OK, so right. I'm implicitly passing here to maybe the completion so that. So sorry, I mean, it doesn't really make sense to talk about split inverse here. Well, imagine that inside the ball times the ball, you have some kind of cone which contracts very thinly to x.
Okay.
That's the kind of situation I'm considering. So you have this, maybe there are several different fibers here, and you have this thing which very thinly contracts down to x. And if you have a sheaf there, then the nearby cycles will be concentrated at this point, but the cohomology there will be the compact support cohomology, which goes too far. And so you have to make sure that these kinds of examples don't occur in the situations you want.
This condition of constructible, I mean, is it enough to check this for the skyscraper G or something like this?
Skyscrapers are never constructible.
Okay, but I mean, in this way, this is a very difficult to check because you have to check it for all G.
Right, but I mean, you can check it in practice because it's assumed that it's true if F is a local system and script F is a local system and this small F, this morphism is smooth, cohomologically smooth, and quasi compact. And it's preserved under push RF lower shriek in general. And so, well, then using some formal procedures. I mean, for example, on the dimmer zero resolutions, you have some local systems. They have this property, and then push them forward to the stratum, and then they're still locally, universally locally. Can be done.
OK, so do you still have other questions from Beijing?
No, thank you. That'd be all for Beijing.
OK, so other questions in Paris?
Yes. So in the classical geometric Satake, the category of proverse sheaf is equivalent to the category of representations of GU. Mm-hmm. That in this setup of Beilinson plus Grassmannian, what is the representation category supposed to be?
Well, still the same, right? Still the same. Representations of the GU group. And so this is if you work over CP, but actually this affine Grassmannian is defined over QP. And then if you encode the descent datum, you actually also get the L group.
Is it possible to define nearby cycle from perverse sheaves on the bigger arm of Grassmannian toward the one of Zimwang-Zhu?
So the question was whether you had this base in Drinfeld Grassmannian, whose generic fibers is Beilinson plus Grassmannian, the special fibers is Witt vector from Grassmannian of Zimwang-Zhu. And so whether you can have some nearby cycles there. And yes, I think you do. And it might be possible to deduce his result by applying nearby cycles to the result of a Beilinson plus. I think if your group is defined over ZP, you can also directly define all these Beilinson-Drinfeld Grassmannians, not just over spa L times spa L, but over spa OL times spa OL, and then have some of this Witt vector from Grassmannian always in the picture still.
Other questions?
Yes, sir. In your abstract, I think you mentioned something like collapsing 2 points of space there.
Well, that's basically what you do, right? I mean, spa L times spa L is like spec Z times spec Z, essentially, locally at P. Like, L is essentially QP. And then you have something like spec QP times spec QP over some more absolute base. And then I'm restricting to the diagonal. And so this essentially means that it's locally the local pic. It's, I mean, this picture is local subset, an open subset of spec Z times spec Z, and I didn't restrict to the diagonals. I'm taking 2 points and collapsing them.
Same point.
What do you mean the same? Well, but I mean, I'm infinitesimally away from P already, right? So I'm deformed a little away from P. Now I have 2 points which are close to P but different, and then I can collapse them again.
Okay, so if there are no other questions, let's thank the speaker again.